Do you throw exceptions to communicate application or domain errors? I hope not, but still I must ask. I will now show you the distinction between errors and exceptions so you don't mix them up. The story begins here with this endpoint in a minimal API application. This particular endpoint creates a new author in the bookstore database. I want to insert a person named John Doe. He's an American, but I will omit the last name in the input. That should not pass. There is the HTTP status 400 response, bad request. It says that the last name is required. Just so. I am correcting my error and trying again. Status 200 is back this time, along with the JSON with the newly created entity. I want to send the same request again, but something unexpected just happened. The database suddenly went down and the new request is hanging. Then it fails, with an unhandled exception, pouring a lot of implementation details into the outer world. Not handling exceptions is not only dirty, but it also poses a security risk due to leaking the internal details of the system. By the time the database recovers, I have changed the culture name to an invalid string. How will the application cope with such an error? Not that I have seen it coming, but it's another unhandled exception. Only this time it looks a bit more structured. It is the culture info class that threw it. Unlike the connectivity issues, I know how to handle this exception. Not every exception is the same. Let me show you that division among exceptions in code. The first task is to stop the propagation of unhandled exceptions. Everything below this point just handles the request, ignoring any exceptions. Still, it validates the input, catching the missing last name, for example. It collects all the errors and returns them with the HTTP status 400 bad request. No exceptions involved. Still, you saw two kinds of exceptions while I was using the application. One exception originated from this line. The culture info class could not deserialize an input string, yet this validation error did not end up in the list of validation errors. A null string would show up in the list of faulty fields, but an invalid string would cause an exception. This if-else instruction shows that you can either return an error object or throw it as an exception. Which form do you prefer? I will start fixing the unhandled exceptions and the answer will come naturally. Exceptions are inevitable, and so I will separate the work into two chunks. One is the code I already have, which handles nothing. The other part is to wrap it into try-catch. What do we catch then, and how do we handle it? You must always have a catch-all block at the outermost point. It will tell the caller the operation has failed without disclosing the reasons. It is a status code 500, internal server error. Think twice before you leak any information to the caller here, lest it become a security issue. But then the information is lost, isn't it? That is where the second action comes. Logging. Log everything, including the stack trace and the exception message. Log the call parameters too. You might need all the data to reproduce the issue later, but remove sensitive data. If we imagine the full name contained sensitive information, we would hide it before logging. This completes the common protocol for handling exceptional errors. Loss of database connectivity, corrupt index, and similar errors are exceptional to the regular application flow. This protocol applies to every endpoint in the application. It pays off to pull it into a reusable method. The culture info class throws the other exception we had, and it is nothing like the exceptions we have handled here. It is not a candidate for the internal server error. The catch-all block is hiding the exceptions. A proper, specific catch block is handling an exception. It applies a remediation. An invalid culture name is a bad request, telling the caller they should fix the error on their end before trying again. It comes with a specific response body too. I am creating the validation errors list with the culture field marked as invalid. This code demonstrates the protocol we apply when we choose to pass application errors as exceptions. You can do it this way if you like, but please be advised that this is not a good protocol. I will now demonstrate its deficiencies. I am running the application again, trying to create that same author one more time, but I am still putting the invalid culture name and omitting the last name. The moment of truth. The status 400 is back as expected. But look at the error list. It doesn't mention the last name, only the culture name is there. That is the principal deficiency of passing errors via the exceptions. There can be only one exception. When an exception is thrown from this line, it masks any other validation errors. That brings us to a fundamental question about exception handling, which hardly anyone will explain to you. The question is, where do we handle an exception? My answer, and you may contest it, is as follows. Either now or never. Now means at the place where you call a method that might throw. Never means at the topmost point in the component, or a layer, or the application where your code ends. That will invariably be a catch-all block, which merely admits that something went wrong. There is nothing in between these two places. This catch block here is, for example, a misplaced one. It breaks the encapsulation of the method below, hurting its future maintainability. I will fix that issue in a minute. Before that, let me remind you that you can download the entire source code from my Patreon page. Patrons are the reason why this channel is free. If you become a patron, you will help hundreds of other programmers watch more than 100 videos on my channel for free. Now, this problem with exceptions is why the creators of C# chose not to include checked exceptions in the language, which exists in Java. I also think that checked exceptions were a mistake in Java, but who could have known at that time? Let's talk about that topic in the comments if you are interested. I will now apply that rule I have given you. This catch block will go. It never belonged here. It always belonged below where the exception originates. Catch it here and then handle it with a vengeance. If you cannot handle the exception, just don't catch it. Let it bubble up and end in the log for someone to figure out what's going on. I'm eager to run the application again. I'm repeating that same faulty call, but this time I expect a different response. The status 400 is back, but with both faulty fields listed. That will help reduce the pressure on the service. The caller should now fix both errors before calling again rather than fixing one error at a time. Pressing execute again. It is another status 400 saying the author's handle is in use. The big change is that any exception will now appear in the log, where developers will pay attention to it. Let me show you one such exception. A long time ago, the founding fathers of this company, who were two founding mothers in fact, envisioned a feature we never implemented. The idea was to allow for a missing handle. The application would then create a handle from the person's name. The result is an internal server error with no other details. That is great news, in fact. The exception we have logged is telling too much. Any hacker would love to know the database name or the schema. Still, we developers see an attempt to insert null into a non-nullable column key. There is also the entire request at the bottom. We see that this happens when the handle field is not populated. Have you ever heard of people intentionally inserting a broken link into their application? It is a useful technique. You leave a feature incomplete and then check the logs to see how many users are interested in that feature. If nobody falls into the trap, then just don't waste your time on that feature. That exception in the log has brought the team's attention to this method, which is currently incomplete. The implementation would construct a handle for an entity which is unique to all entities of that type in the database. You don't have to read this code, it just works. The rest is to modify how we call that implementation. The implementation is irrelevant. Please pay attention to how we came to implement a feature. The users made invalid calls, but the sheer amount of errors in the log caused by the same input brought the understanding that the users need that feature. So we implemented it, and I'm running the application one last time. It is that same request again, with the handle missing. Executing the request will lead to the HTTP status 200 this time. There you see the URL of the newly created resource. The application has created a unique handle from the person's name by adding the digit to avoid collision as requested. This completes the story of exceptions and application errors as I see them. Use objects to convey information about application and domain errors. That gives you freedom and flexibility. Catch implementation exceptions and transform them into custom error objects to make error handling uniform across the application. Let any exception you cannot handle bubble up to the outermost point in the component or application. Be nice to the user, but not too nice. Hide the error details from them. Log the error details instead. Use that information to understand your application and users' requests better. Use it to improve the application progressively over time by adding new features and improving the existing ones.